Since the beginning of time, men have tried to do things that didn't always make sense or were seen as pointless and foolish and really, really dumb. Well, keeping this tradition in mind, we welcome you to a new kind of television show.
Well, you know, in a way, well, it may seem like that, but we're not here to criticize, and maybe you should consider the same approach.
It's time for the Red Green Show, starring my own uncle since birth, Red Green.
Thank you very much, and welcome to the show, and thank you for tuning us in as you zap through the channels in hopes of finding something better on. Certainly appreciate the opportunity. Yeah, we had a heck of a time up the lodge this week. We built ourselves our very own water slide. And you know, speaking of water slides, Harold, come on over here. Harold is a producer and director of our show. They tell me he has some sort of a sense of production, and also he has this machine that does things.
Oh, you mean this? It's a video effects machine. It enables me to go to pre-taped segments if I deem it desirable. If not essential.
This is a team effort to do a show like this. And actually, building the water slide was a team effort, too. We all had to dig right in, pitch in, and work together.
Excuse me, Uncle Red. You know, you gotta remember sometimes that a break is just as important as the work itself, right? Now, I realize you're just about to tell this wonderful story about the water slide, but as your producer, I might suggest that you just sort of go on to the next segment, right? And that way, you can have a break. Let me show you.
I've got a terrible headache I've had all day. It throbs and it pounds and it won't go away. I got it from driving that van of mine. I'm either going to have to start wearing a seatbelt or slowing down for the speed bumps. This week in the handyman corner, we're going to show you how you can repair these little annoying nicks and cracks and stone chips and what have you in your windshield. They have a new product out now. It's kind of a liquid glass silicone kind of a deal. But before we get to the silicone liquid glass, there's a few steps that you have to take. For example, you have to take the crack that's in the windshield, and you have to isolate it by punching a hole at each end of the crack so that the cracks won't spread. All right, now what's happened here is we've actually created a few more cracks. So we have to now isolate them by putting holes at the end of those cracks. And so on. All right, I seem to have all the cracks isolated so that the remainder of the windshield will still be safe. Now what we do is we take this belt sander and we have to rough up the edges of the chips of glass so that the silicone will stick to it. All right, we seem to have created a bit more of a problem here, so we have to kind of abandon the silicone liquid glass kind of a solution, and we have to go with another way to solve our problem using the handyman's secret weapon, duct tape. All right, well, we got the duct tape to kind of hold her in place there. We just want to tap it in to make it kind of be watertight. The rain will get in there, sure as heck. Also, there we go. Clean as a whistle, no cracks, perfect visibility, and you get the added benefit of the fresh air and the ventilation coming at you while you're driving. And any of the downside of this particular repair job is more than offset by my auxiliary windshield. So that's how easy it is to do your own windshield repairs. I would highly recommend some sort of safety gloves when you're breaking the glass up. So until next time, remember, if women don't find you handsome, they should at least find you handy. Wait a minute, it's got a crack in it. Don't go away. I've got a story to finish and a show to finish.
Uncle Red's stories always finish the show for me.
is autumn, Halloween. I follow the path of the pumpkin. First it's a jack-o'-lantern, then it's a pumpkin pie. Would have tasted better if we'd taken out the candle. So anyway, as I was saying, we wanted to build this water slide, and the first thing we needed was the slide part, and boy, those things are expensive. So what we did was we went out at night, and we just stole animal feed troughs from farms in the area. And what the heck, you know, I mean, animals having a place to eat is not near as important as us having fun. And besides, them farmers are all on government subsidies anyway.
I don't think you can justify trough theft by saying it's just for fun, nor taking a cheap shot at the poor farmers of this great country. It doesn't do much for your image, and I'll admit I'm disappointed in you. Aww. Speaking of your nephew.
It's just a story, Harold.
Wow.
All right. We didn't steal the feed troughs. We found them on our own property, eventually. And maybe I'm wrong. Maybe farmers aren't getting government subsidies. Maybe the alfalfa crop paid for those Cadillacs. I don't know. Anyway, we attached the troughs all together using the handyman's secret weapon, duct tape. And then we ran the chain of troughs from the roof of the lodge all the way down to the lake.
Boy, that sounds great, Uncle Red. Way to go. That sounds like a lot of work. Break time!
Well, why would I want to take a break now, Harold?
Because, basically, you're a kind person.
We're out here on location with my good buddy, Dougie Franklin, right here, and his amazing monster truck. Dougie, how are you today?
I'm fine. Thank you very much.
Well, I'm glad to hear that, because, you know, Doug, last time we were here, Doug said he'd take us for a little spin in the truck, and well, we're kind of excited about it, so today's the day. Here we are, Doug.
Well, last time when I made you that offer, Red had my license, and I'm afraid it's been suspended.
For a while, just a while.
Oh, my gosh, Doug. What happened? A speeding ticket, run a red light, have an accident? What was it?
Yeah.
Oh, you had a bad day.
Well, I did. I was caught doing about 60 miles an hour down a sidewalk. Took out a red light, and actually I took out the pole that was holding it up as well. And I had a slight altercation with a few automotive vehicles.
A few?
Nine vehicles, nine cars.
Oh, my gosh. Was anybody hurt?
Well, there's an upside. That'd be the upside. Fortunately, nobody was hurt. They was all parked, all nine of them in a row at one of them BMW dealerships, or Bimmers, I think they call them.
Oh, my gosh. You ran into nine BMWs?
No. Imelda here, she doesn't run into nothing. I ran over BMWs. But fortunately, God bless her, I've just got a little scratch on the bottom of my oil pan. When you're mounting one of those BMWs, you know, up the side, the sunroof has a tendency to flip up on you, and that's what happened. It's the sunroof's come up, and actually, it's right under there. It scraped my oil pan right out.
Gosh, thanks.
Yeah. But it's okay.
I hope you were insured for all this, Doug.
Well, I was insured, but not anymore. I called the insurance company, you know, moments after. Had a friend's mobile phone in Imelda there, and called down, and that insurance salesman, he was down there in just a matter of minutes. He must live right nearby. He was a perky little fella. He was right down there, and a couple of minutes later, this insurance adjuster, I think they call him, he come in tow.
Yeah.
And I guess probably about, just a matter of minutes after he was there, this crowd started gathering around, and you know, as I said, there's a good side. You got to look on the bright side.
Yeah.
And the bright side of this was I got some great publicity out of it. I learned something.
Uh-huh.
You know, everything is, it's a big experience in this life.
Yeah.
And I learned something. I learned that, for example, them poles that hold up the stoplights, they hold up a lot more than the stoplight, I'll tell you that right now. That they hold up... They also hold up the streetlight. They hold up power transformers. And they also hold up enough cable there, enough to power up the entire downtown core, I'll tell you that. And there's one funny thing I found. It's like a dream, but I can remember it. It's a funny thing. You know them bus shelters? You hit one of them at 60 mile an hour. And when they explode, They make kind of a popping sound. It's like a bang. It was just all over. The funniest little sound. It's a weird, thing.
Well, you learned a lot.
I did. You do learn. There's a downside, but there's always an upside. That's what I'm saying, I guess.
Best of luck to you, Doug.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
All right.
Thank
you. Dougie Franklin, a man who's a little wiser.
I am.
Not too much wiser, but a little wiser.
Well, you gotta take your bumps. That's what I'm doing here, sitting on this baby, and I can't drive her nowhere.
9 BMWs, eh?
Yeah. I'll tell you, I learned something else, too. People don't like them yuppies too much. They were applauding when they looked at them things wrecked.
Yeah.
Well, I guess it just goes to show you drive one of those, all you're doing is telling everybody how much money you got and how little everybody else has,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Well, you rose above them, didn't you?
I certainly did. I rose above all of them. Yeah. And over them and down the other side.
That's the important part.
I was. I come out ahead.
There's a time in the evening when everything is still, when the moon's doing things that the sun never will. It's a magical time, it's good for your soul. And someone makes an incredibly rude noise and brings you back to reality.
I said I was sorry.
You killed the fire.
Well, Uncle Red, I hope you're ready for today's mail because we got some interesting questions. Better put on your thinking cap. They're really deep, and we want some deep answers.
All right, 50 fathoms.
50 fathoms? That's funny. 50 fathoms, that's really funny. Because I said some deep questions, so you said, like, a deep answer because that's how, like, they measure the depths of water, bodies of water with fathoms. 50 fathoms. That's I'm going to write that down, Uncle Rad. That's one of your better ones. Fathoms, 50 fathoms. How do you spell fathoms?
Just read the letter, Harold.
Oh, I should just probably get it right.
Make me kill you.
Letter number one. Dear Red, what is the meaning of life?
All right, Harold, I'd like to answer that question in two parts. Okay. Who knows and who cares?
Excellent. Oh, that's really deep. That's fantastic. That's great. It's very, what do they say? It's like existential. Who cares? That's existentialism or is it alienation, confusion? Is it confusion more so?
The next letter, Harold.
The next letter. All right, here we go. Letter number two. Dear Red, do you think we should teach the Bible in school?
Well, Harold, as you know, I read the Bible a great deal with the amount of time I spend in motels. And I find that the Bible has a great deal to say to young people of today, even 20 centuries after it's written it. I think young people should read the Bible and they should enjoy it. It has a lot to teach them and it has some tremendous insights into life. So no, I think you should keep it out of the school system altogether.
Excellent. Right to the point. Wonderful, Uncle Red. Okay, letter number three. Dear Red, sometimes I stand alone on the top of a hill at night and stare up at the stars for hours and hours, marveling at their beauty and complexity. And then suddenly I burst into tears and throw up. And I wonder, are we alone in this universe?
Well, I'm not, but it sounds like you are.
Well, that was very nice. It was maybe perhaps a bit insensitive, granted, but it was direct to the viewer. That's the important thing, I suppose. Okay, well, that's very good. Well, well answered. Thank you very much, Uncle Red.
Fathoms.
Something a little bit different for you on this adventure with Bill this week. I'm going to show you about signaling. What that thing there is some sort of a smog bomb. Bill, you know, goes up just a little bit too far. And if you inhale that stuff, apparently, it can kill you. However, these are the chances you take. And this is a big mirror. He's going, oh, thank you, Bill, thank you. And then this is real bright, you know, in every way. And, of course, he's... Yeah. And now Bill can't see where he's going. And
Wow!
Well, you can even signal with pieces of a mirror, apparently. But luckily, we brought the sunglasses with us. And here's some other things you can signal with us, like a lady's hand mirror and a butcher knife, which isn't a bad idea to have around when Bill's there. Mirror off my van, and this is a little lighter, and I guess that'd be a fry pan there. And This is a bust of Elvis. You don't have too many of those, but they got the silver sunglasses on them. You can signal with those. And a can of... Oh. I should have said an empty can. This is probably better. Boy, that spaghetti-o can really stick to you. And then there's the whistle. But Bill. Oh, is that loud? Oh, ow, 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 oh. Elvis has left the building. Now these are some signal flags. I think you get more signaling out of what's coming off his underarms than you do out of the flags. Bill's a kind of an unusual human being, isn't he? He can almost fly, I would think. His head is light enough. Oh, there they go. Look out. Ah, there's right. And then he had something. I kind of like this. This is a signal kite. You put SOS on it, and then you send it up, and I guess a plane flying over, or maybe somebody looking up into the sky seeing it, knows that, you know, at the other end of the string, there's somebody in trouble. Boy, is that ever true. So we got her up there, flying up there pretty good, and she was going out. He's getting 1,000, 2,000 feet, and all of a sudden, we got a snag, and it darn thing had wrapped itself around the hydro wire. Anyway, you know. Oh, thank you. Thank you, Bill. And the idea was, here's another method of signaling. This is a gun. You shoot four shots in the air. Universal signal. Of course, what we didn't realize was he was shooting right at the hydro wire that had the kite on it. And down she comes, and there's about 10,000 volts there. Oh, my golly. Now, here's one that we kind of stole from the Indians, using a blanket to signal with. And the problem here is Bill didn't remember where the broken glass was. It's right there, Bill. Yeah. Oh, boy. But I had some vice grips with me, so we got that out of there. Oh, this won't hurt. Oh. So I went and got another blanket, put that over the fire. And the idea is you let the blanket kind of sit on there, let the smoke build up, so that when you release it, you know, it's going to give you a real good puff that'll go way up into the air. So we flip her off, and well, it wasn't real successful. Of course, this is because the fire was pretty well dead out. So we got another fire going. I got a real good one going this time. Got another blanket, and threw that on there. And again, you let it kind of build up underneath. And maybe we got the fire just a tad on the warm side. Maybe we need more smoke, and maybe... Boy, it's a good thing Bill knows what to do in an emergency, because he causes a hell of a lot of them. It is winter. A time for quiet walks and peaceful thoughts. To stare blankly at the gentle snowflakes as they fall through the naked trees. And then to slip and bang your head on the lake. Saw a movie from the video store the other day.
Oh, good one?
Well, it was great. It was a time traveling thing. They had a phone booth, and the guys would get in, and the phone booth, they could travel to a different time.
Oh, that sounds excellent.
You ever thought of that?
Oh, getting in a phone booth and just traveling.
Yeah. You know, if you had a time machine, what if you got in it and you went like 10 million years and came right back to when you were right now? Would it be right now, or would it be a different now? Or would it be close to the same now?
It'd be really close to the same
how
now.
How close?
Really close, but only different. What time would you go to if you could time travel?
I'd go to around 7:30.
Today, like the future, or yesterday, or this morning? There's so many.
I'd have to think about it.
You'd have to. You have to be specific.
Yeah. But you know, time flies when you're having fun. As far as we say, time is fun when you're having flies. Get it?
Oh, it's a big joke.
I'd like to apologize to any of the farmers who I may have offended. And if you'll forgive me, I'll tell you the rest of the water slide story.
Don't go for it. It's a trick.
One's still kind of jammed under there.
Well, that's one of them small ones. I think they call them a 3 series.
Yeah.
They're just a four-cylinder
job. Kind of sporty looking, though.
They are. They come with, apparently, if you can get real leather upholstery in that model. Although, if you look at it, the glove compartment is still shut. Perfect. I think the manual and everything's right in there like it was brand new.
I think the keys are in, Doug.
Oh, I doubt she'll turn over on you there, Red.
I know we get a lot of young people
watching our show as some sort of a punishment. And I know Harold gets a chance to talk to you, but, you know, that's more of a contractual thing that he insisted on rather than a segment has any real value to it. Now, to my mind, you need someone a little older, someone maybe who's been down the road a time or two to give you young people some advice on growing up. Like maybe you've just turned 16 and you got your driver's license and you're excited as heck about that, and next thing you know, you've stolen a car. And of course, you want to go down to the high school and start showing off, doing the donuts and the figure eights and the flower beds there, and then get her up onto the two wheels and through the front door of the school so you can peel rubber up and down the halls. I know that sounds like a lot of fun, but please, play it smart. Wear your seatbelt. So anyway, you got a picture of this water slide with all the troughs duct taped together running from the chimney all the way down to the lake. And God, we were all pretty excited about it, you know. So Moose Thompson, he was real rared up. He stripped down to his underwear and away he goes before we'd actually had a chance to put any water on it, you know. I mean, all you could hear was the squealing sound of Moose's skin coming off, you know, and of course the rest of us laugh. And with Moose going first, he soon realized that the water slide went almost to the water, but, you know, not quite. So we put another trough on the end there, and we called 911 for Moose. Then Buster and Stinky had a couple of good runs on it, because we had the water going by then. But it wasn't fast enough for old man Sedgwick. So he took off all his clothes, skivvies and the whole deal, and covered himself with salad oil. Right? Well, we were out of French dressing. And so, I mean, he was really whipping down there. And about two-thirds of the way down, we heard what we hoped was the sound of him breaking the sound barrier. And he comes out the end of the water slide, skips four times across the lake, and lands in the bonfire at the Girl Guides camp. But then he always makes a bad first impression anyway. We all decided, though, that the water slide was too dangerous, and as luck would have it, a minute later it collapsed anyway. So live and learn, or just live, you know. Anyway, if my wife is watching, I'll be coming straight home tonight, and I wouldn't mind a back scratch if you're not too tired. Anyway, so the rest of you, thank you for watching, and on behalf of myself and Harold and all the rest of the gang up here at the lodge, keep your stick on the ice.